Pretty much, because originally it was an hour straight, but it's split by lunch.
Thank you. We'll resume
with Graeme
continuing on the topic.
Thanks, Graeme. No worries. Okay, so before lunch we talked about the old methods, current methods. Now let's talk about one of the new methods that is certainly out there. As I said just before lunch, 15 years we've been working on this. Clearly not the only system out there for continuously monitoring the performance of the track and rolling stock, VTIs, Amstead's Ionic systems. These things are all options for providing you with more, and obviously ENSCO locomotive based and FMG, I'm talking just before. All of these are options for collecting data a lot more frequently. But I'll focus on the one that I've been involved with for a fair while, and we can take it from there. So what, basically over the last 15 years, we've been developing what we refer to as a state-of-the-art instrumented vehicle. We now have 85 of these things sitting around, and there's a few people in this room who would be quite familiar with them and their use. They're autonomous condition monitoring systems set up on your existing revenue rolling stock. So a lot of ours are in fact put on iron ore wagons in the Pilbara or coal wagons in the Hunter Valley. More recently on some of the passenger networks as well. The real intent being to understand the condition of the track by looking at how the wagon or the vehicle is responding on a 24/7 basis. Provides you with things like near real-time reporting of condition of the asset, so you can effectively flick back almost instantaneously, assuming you've got comms of any faults that are sitting out there on track. You can look at things like how effective your maintenance has been. Quite frequently we'll try and do that using track recording cars, but when you've got a 4-month lag in the data, you're not always sure in terms of what's actually happened. Whereas here you might have a run half an hour before the maintenance and a few hours after the maintenance. So you can see almost instantaneously how effective your maintenance was and whether that maintenance is holding. And also from a point of view of projecting forward and providing you with a mechanism for planning your maintenance in the same way that QR does using their track recording car. So we've built over 85 of these, and the companies that are currently using them include BHP, Rio Tinto, Fortescue, Vale in Brazil, the Hunter Valley Coal, V-Line Passenger, used them in South Australia. We've used them for the iron ore traffic in the Kalgoorlie area, Esperance, Cliffs. We've used it for one of the rail CRC projects to look at Cant efficiency. We've used it already on Roy Hill for assessing locomotive performance, and we're now looking at setting up a wagon for them. And we're also talking to MTR and SMRT. To introduce this platform. They come in many shapes and sizes, depending on what your requirements are, but in effect, the example that you can see there in that picture is the Rio Tinto, or one of the many Rio Tinto instrumented wagons, generally using solar in this case. Regular service vehicle, so it's carrying iron ore, it's positioned at all different locations within the train. As we talked about before, the understanding what your in-train forces are. So frequently we've had up to six of these wagons in one train, and you're looking at how the you know, before you came to ECP, you might be looking at how your pneumatic brakes were propagating, or if you're using multiple locos, you know, you might have two sets of remote. How is the signal from the lead locomotive being transferred to the other two, and then how's the brake pressure or brake pipe propagating from those locos as well? So trying to manage your in-train forces, drive trains better. So they're examples sort of outside the track conditioning where these things are used a lot. Tuning the dumper, making sure that the in-train forces during dumping aren't too excessive, because a lot of iron ore operations will struggle a lot through the indexing process through their dumpers. Trying to get the trade-off between maximum ore through the dumpers and not breaking your rolling stock. They're self-contained. We have developed them a long way since day one. The transducers that are now used are a lot more robust. Still quite a challenge in a lot of these environments with the power, making sure you keep solar panels clean, batteries in reasonable nick. Things like passenger vehicles, it becomes infinitely more easy because you get access to power. The fleet that we've now got running in the Hunter Valley are running axle generators, which are proving to be incredibly reliable and providing a lot more power than the solar solution. So they're the types of projects that we're currently working on to make these things better. The IRVs, they're basically tailored to the situation. So we've got examples there of a tanker car where we're that we've instrumented. This is just a typical iron ore wagon. Used to be a lot easier when they had external ribs because you could put lots of solar panels down the side, but now it's a lot more challenging. So we've had to get special solar panels made to fit in little gaps. But you'll have logger boxes sitting on the end of them containing data logging equipment. You've got differential GPS sitting on top of them, so you're down at sub-meter accuracy for measuring locations. Top right is the ARTC example. So we've tucked the data logger in under the end of the wagon, and down the bottom the V-line pass that we've recently been looking at. But the reality is everyone's operation is different, and the first thing that we have to do is come in and work out where the heck you can put the instrumentation, because it's often one of the challenges. I know, for instance, the ones in Vale, we actually had four small boxes around each of the wagons with cables running between them, just simply because of the limited space to work with. Have over 85 of them, as you see down the bottom. They have to go through a pretty harsh life, getting dipped upside down pretty much on a daily basis. So, say the architecture now and the sort of level of knowledge that we have in terms of putting these things into service is pretty good. We've had very few failures over the course of the years. What can the instrumented revenue vehicle do? What do we actually go out there and measure? And so there's two columns there. One's the instrumented revenue vehicle. The other's a track recording vehicle. Well, the first thing that we do with an IRV is we measure the dynamic response of the wagon. So we're effectively trying to understand, Is the ride okay? Are the dynamic loads going through the side frames okay? Is there high impacts at the rail running surface? We monitor vehicle in-train forces, rail running surface, while track recording car does that. Highly accurate locations. In addition, we've now got to the point where we can measure the top of the rail running surface, effectively giving and I'll show you an example shortly of the overlay between the top that we're measuring and the top from a track recording car. We can't measure the lateral alignment of the two rails, but one of the things we're now doing is putting bogey steer on. So we have roll rate sensors sitting on the bolster, looking at how the wagon or the bolster, the bogey is effectively tracking. So clearly if there's going to be an alignment issue, things like the steer of the bolster or steer of the bogey is a good measure of the lateral condition or lateral alignment of the track. We do super elevation, we do twist, and again I'll show you examples where we've overlaid that against the data from track recording vehicles, and I think you'll see that they're a pretty good system for picking those up. So one of the things we've tried to focus on, at the outset we didn't do any of that, but we've realised that the railways like that information, or as we've talked about before, it's heritage legacy, track recording data. So we've tried to go down the path of presenting the end user with information that they're familiar with, as well as the important dynamic stuff. Can't do gauge, that's one that we're still struggling with. You need to start to get cameras and a whole bunch of other things on board to measure gauge. And when you're putting things through rotary dumpers and you need very accurate alignment, and you also need lots of power, that's a challenge that's so far escaped us, but not to say that we won't get there one day. Curvature, so things like, same thing in terms of steer, we also pick up the curvature of the track. One of the real valuable aspects is it's sitting in revenue service. You don't have to go out there and schedule an IRV to run separately. It's out there all the time. It's running 24/7. It's carrying passengers. It's carrying coal. It's carrying iron ore. So it's understanding the condition of the track as the product or end user is perceiving it. In one of the networks, we're getting 100 recordings a week. I think our lowest is around 3 per week, where we've only got one wagon in service. We talked about before how frequently a track recording vehicle runs. I guess for those that are standalone, I think the minimum is about 2 weeks and anything up to a few years. Clearly, ENSCOs, locomotive-based, will be out there all the time. So there are similarities, and they don't require separate train paths. So, clearly, that's another way to go. And as I said, measures under the dominant vehicle loading. So, for instance, we measure under the empty condition and the loaded condition. You can see slight differences between the empty and loaded surface. Where you might have a bog hole, for instance, you can see the track deflect a little bit more under the loaded wagon. Again, we put a bunch of transducers on it. We've got a GPS antenna that typically sits up the top here, got equipment cabinet somewhere. In case of IRTC, we've got an axle generator. We generally measure side frame, the suspension travel through the springs. We put rotation sensors both vertically and horizontally to pick up super, cross level and bogey steer. For the heavy haul networks, we'll do brake pipe, brake cylinder pressures, so we can look at how the wave is propagating down the train. So with ECP, it's instantaneous, but clearly when we started this stuff in 2002, most of the networks we were dealing with were still pneumatic. Now, one of the projects that was undertaken was the justification of ECP brakes. How much value or how much benefit can you get if you're going to go from a pneumatic to an ECP system in terms of the reduction in maybe stopping distances or in-train forces, coupler damage, all of those sorts of things. And we put an accelerometer on the side frame. That's picking up the wax going through IRJs, dipped welds. It's also doing the rail running surface. Again, most of this stuff is now quite robust. It's gone through a lot of product development. So that's effectively what a basic instrumented wagon might look like. At the same time, we can put additional transducers on. We've done a lot of strain measurements in terms of validating the performance of new wagons coming in, particularly for a wagon going through a rotary dumper or something like that, making sure that the strains aren't excessive when you're turning the sidewall into the floor of the wagon. We then feed that data back to manufacturers who might need to strengthen their designs. Temperature is another big one. Noise, and so brake pipe as opposed to brake cylinder. Do roll pitch and yaw. So things like vehicle ride is an area that we can now continuously monitor. And in the case where we can't put axle generators, as per this picture, we'll have solar or onboard power. So pretty simple layout, but and reasonably robust design now. So, you know, things like, you know, IP60, 65 ratings, mil-spec connectors. So it's generally a pretty robust set of hardware. So as I said, we do have some similarities with track geometry cars. We put, in fact, these high-precision accelerometers on the side frame. And because that's effectively a direct solid link between the two, and if it's not, we might put it on the bearing itself. By doing some fancy mathematics of the output from that accelerometer, we can match the profile of the rail very accurately, and I'll show you an example. We also put roll rate sensors on, and they're effectively measuring the change in angle, basically as you might go around a curve or as you go through a dip. Your vertical sensor, roll rate sensor, will be showing you the degree of the dip. And they're the ones that we're using to start to estimate cross level and twist. We used to put it's about $40,000 inertial system on to measure cross level, which had GPS, high precision GPS all over the place. We've actually found a roll rate sensor that's giving us data that's infinitely more reliable and a lot less grief. Then, as I say, I'll show you some examples of what this data looks like. You've got four plots there: super elevation, twist, rail running surface on left and right, east and west. The red line is a track recording car. The black line is the instrumented revenue vehicle. I think most people would look at that and go, that's pretty much the same. So do you therefore need a track geometry car out there monitoring these parameters if you've got an instrumented revenue vehicle? Again, we don't measure alignment, we don't measure gauge. But certainly the relationship between those is, and we haven't just made this one up for the purposes of presentation, it is real data. So we're pretty confident that, you know, we've got four of the six principal parameters that track recording cars are asked to measure being covered. This is the point we made before, differences between empty and loaded. This is the rail running surface between empty and loaded. You can actually see sort of subtle differences here between the pink and the blue. We think that's the difference between the loaded and the empty. Very small amounts, differences in deflection between the two runs. So you've got something like four runs. Again, high level of repeatability between the two sets of data. One of the things we talked about before, and this probably isn't the best example, but the top three parameters there are your vertical, so your running surface, left and right, twist, and a couple of different twist rates. Down the bottom, you've actually got, the two bottom ones are actually the dynamic responses. So you can actually see here there's quite a high response of the wagon, and there's actually quite a bit of geometry error at that location. But you look at this area here, again, a lot less surface twist type errors, but the total response isn't that different. So again, the wagon is going to respond very differently depending on how it perceives the particular error that's sitting in the track. So again, this is stuff that we've talked about already before. You know, is the geometry data, or you need to be able to combine that geometry data to understand how a vehicle is going to respond to it. So let's measure all of it. Let's measure the geometry and let's measure the response of the wagon at the same time. So from a vehicle dynamics perspective, one of the main things and one of the stuff we did from the very outset is measure the suspension travel here. That's in effect a measure of the dynamic load going into the track. So things like Eisenman track condition factors, you could almost infer from this type of response. So the way in which your dynamic load going into the track varies along the length of the track gives you some sort of assessment of the condition of the track. We use that a lot in terms of trying to work out whether you can increase axle loads. These are the types of the long wavelength, geometry errors, cross-level twist, alignment and surface will generally manifest themselves through basically a dynamic or long wavelength dynamic response of the wagon. So either a body rock or a pitch or a bounce or something like that. And you'll pick this up, and I'll show you some examples later of the data coming out from these. So that's been one of the key things that we've been measuring. It's gone through a lot of iterations over the years. We started with contact systems, so displacement transducers, but we found the dust and the dirt and connections, and we've actually now gone to a strain gauge based system, and we get very high reliability out of this now. It used to be probably our second biggest problem behind power. But it gives you a huge amount of information and would generally correlate, as I say, with your alignments and surfaces type errors, or your output from your Vampire or your new cars, the longer wavelength stuff. It's not a particularly clear plot, I'm afraid. I've buggered it up a bit. But what we do is the suspension travel is effectively... we could probably turn the lights down, but it doesn't really matter. Obviously, all the data comes back linked to the GPS position, and we then look at each of the suspensions. So that's the four spring nests, in fact, on a single bogey in this case, showing the dynamic response. In this case, it happens to be sort of a bounce or a pitch response, so it's very much in phase. But we then process that data by here we go. It's all right, the next slide will be bright, Ravi.
Okay.
That's all right. Anyway, you get the idea. We get lots of squiggly lines, and we'll see more of them in a little bit. Be it an example, we talked about mud holes and how to prioritise mud holes. I believe some railroads might have mud holes, even in Australia. So this was an example where we had the mud hole. We've got the vertical alignment, the twist data, and we also can then determine how severe the response at that mud hole is by looking at either a bounce mode or a roll mode of the wagon travelling through that location. So what it's basically able to do, and it was the thing that we were talking about before, is how do you prioritise which of these things are causing you the maximum grief? If you're measuring the response of the wagon to each of them, then in my view, it would be a very good way to start to prioritise your maintenance tasks. I remember the case when we first introduced instrumented wagons to Vale in Brazil. We set the same severity 1 limits that we had for the railroads in the Pilbara, and effectively you had a continuous output of severity 1s for the entire length of the track. So we then changed the reporting criteria to say, just give us the top 100. We'll see if we can focus on those. And John, you might have made some comments before about how we set limits. Well, we set limits so that we can manage them generally. You know, as engineers, we'll say, well, Jesus, if I put in more than that, someone's going to kill me. So we'll set a line somewhere so that it's a manageable number. With mud holes or any track error that's out there, effectively you want to know what the worst is and you want to go in there and repair it. This type of information, and sometimes that's hard to infer from geometry data. So I think this gives you, you know the dynamic load that it's causing, and hence it's a pretty good estimation of the damage that's occurring to your network, be it the rolling stock or the track. As I say, we also have this accelerometer that sits on the side frame. It's looking at the unsprung mass. So the unsprung mass is going to respond to any of the short wavelength defects that are sitting on the rail. So a dipped weld, corrugations, insulated rail joints, switches, where there's poor, where the wheel perceives a irregular running surface, this thing here is going to respond. So we use it, as I say, for two reasons. One, to identify sort of a whackometer to say, okay, Jesus, there's something bad out there on the rail that we need to go and fix. And the second level is to measure the rail profile, the rail running surface. As we showed previously, it's a pretty accurate means of doing that. Oops, move on. So this, for example, is monitoring an IRJ through instrumented wagon. It's quite old data, but you can see the high accelerations. We don't actually know maintenance, but one assumes that maintenance has occurred here. Deterioration, maintenance, deterioration. So it's really good at looking at the effectiveness, well, one, the condition of each of your assets, and one of the things we do is provide track feature reports. So effectively, you can pull up all of your IRJs and rank them from best to worst. It could be bridges, it could be switches, using this type of analysis. Detection of well condition. This is some work that we did for one of the heavy haul. That's actually looking at the profile of the rail as measured by the side frame acceleration. Each of these is a peaked weld associated with each of a flash butt weld every 25 metres. Bang, bang, bang. So you can get down to that level of detail using this type of instrumentation. It was interesting. How many railway systems here will set their rail weld limits based on a millimetre, 0.3 millimetres plus 0.3 minus zero or something like that in terms of a condition index for your welds? I suspect there might be a few. That's the correlation between the height or dip of a weld and the acceleration. This is the correlation between the ramp angle as perceived by that weld and the acceleration. Again, it's not the height of the weld that matters, it's how the wheel perceives that weld. So again, in terms of understanding the condition or whether you need to grind something or take off the peak, it's important to know that you're measuring the right piece of information. And most people get a straight edge, yet she's within tolerance. May not be the best parameter to be monitoring. Might be the easiest one to monitor, but is it actually giving you useful information? Done. 2:30. yes?
A quick question, and a real question this time. You were talking about use of solar panels to power this?
Yep.
Or the use of onboard, or the use of an
axle generator?
Yeah. As the energy requirements of this equipment comes down into the future, is there opportunity for energy harvesting across suspension components?
Yeah,
I don't know enough about that.
No, we're still a long way away from, we're still drawing a fair whack of power. We've looked at, in fact, we had a master's or PhD, yes. PhD student look at energy harvesting for exactly that reason. And we basically got to the point where you can harvest enough energy for a single transducer, but when you're trying to do, these are pretty high level, this is all measuring continuous data, of kilohertz filtering, so it's drawing a fair whack of power. That's one of the, I suppose, disadvantages of our systems compared to VTIs, which might be collecting bursts of information or they're not continuously collecting.
Or simpler systems that might just do as much power as, say, an iPhone.
Yeah, the ionics, which I think just basically transmits in bursts rather than continuous. I mean, we like the fact that, and I'll show you later, the continuous data, because it allows you to trend really what's going on with your asset.
So your power requirements are too high, energy harvesting
is still too low.
One day you might just think about it.
But one of the things we're exploring very vigorously at the moment is better axle generators, for instance. Our very first instrumented wagons when ECP was first introduced, there were wireless ECP systems. I think it was it GE who introduced them?
Harris.
Yeah. They had a generator, they designed a generator for the axle, because they needed power on every wagon to run the ECP. We squirreled away about 20 of those at the outset, but then they stopped producing them because they're actually a very effective way. So we think that the real opportunity in the future, if we do continue to need high power, will be through better use of axle-based generation systems.
All right, thanks. Can I stop for a comment on these? When you install this gear, it's really good, it gives you lots of great data. You must understand you now own another asset. And you must attribute the ownership of that asset to someone, and then someone's got to make sure they're doing the maintenance on it. Graham should give us the reports on how many of these of our instrument ore cars and how effective they were. And from that, we fell into a bit of a hole, and we dug ourselves out by saying, look, right. it out, but you own it, and now you've got the maintenance orders coming from the faults going through. Because otherwise, you spend all this money and all this great gear, and all of a sudden you've got no data coming through. What happened? Because the track maintainers were using the data, but the rolling stock guys weren't maintaining it because it was just another widget they had to deal with, and they were more focused on trading and bearing. So it's a really easy one to do, but it's part of the operational readiness when you're installing it, and we should be mindful of it for any of these new technology systems is once the project's delivered, someone in the maintenance organisation's got to own it, and that comes back to what competency do you have in the organisation to maintain it.
Thank you. Can I have my water? Yeah.
Okay, I'm back.
Give you an overview quickly. I think I have 45 minutes to some of the detection and monitoring technologies are out there. Some things we've had for years, some things are just appearing on the horizon. I just want to outline these for you in sort of an overview sense like I did last night. So this will be like a 30,000 foot view of the landscape of what we're dealing with in our current state of the systems. Again, last night, if you weren't there, I kind of have a disclaimer to start that I'm not here to push any one product over another or say that any of these technologies will work on your railroad system. I'm here just to give you a broad overview of the technologies. I would encourage everyone to do their own investigations as to the viability, feasibility, reliability of these systems for your operations. And what works in one area may not work in another, like Graham just pointed out. Very easy to put things on passenger vehicles. Clean, you got power, you got comm communications, versus putting something out there that gets turned upside down in a dumper every other day with dust and dirt and grime and grease. So you got to really tailor these to what you can live with. Also, last night I mentioned this, if you weren't there. When I did this paper for the speech or lecture last night, I talked to a number of rail operators and I said, what are you looking for in detection technology? And the two big things that top the list, I call them the big A's that came out, were autonomy and automation. They want autonomous systems that don't require manpower, don't require track time. The IRV is a prime example of what they like. Okay, something that can just run, collect data, report it without human intervention and what have you. Second thing, they want automated algorithms to sift through the data to give them answers and not data. They don't want to deal with big grass and piles of stuff and what have you. They want answers as to what to fix and when I need to fix it to make my system safer. So those are the two biggies. A couple other ones. Accuracy, of course. They want repeatability, reliability, accuracy. They don't want to be chasing after false positives. Okay. They want to know when they go out there to fix something, it needs fixing. All right. Asset management. Most all these systems feed into some kind of asset management database, big data, to do condition reporting and what have you, and they want to be able to access these databases 360, 724, around the clock, on their phones, on their home computers, wherever they are. They want to be able to look at things. So they want accessibility, and the last thing, it must work in all kinds of weather. Sub-zero weather to very hot desert conditions, dry to humid, etc., etc. Okay, so what do we have out there? I think there's a group, what I'll call them legacy systems. We've all been exposed to them over the years. They've been around ultrasonic detection, geometry measurements for 40 or 50 years. They've evolved naturally, but we've all grown up familiar with many of these systems. Then there's a group I call the sort of cutting-edge systems, the new and developing technologies, like automated machine vision for grading and inspecting sleepers, vision systems to inspect fasteners, bolts, plates, and rail seat abrasion, track deflection measurement, track stiffness, rail surface conditions, micro cracks, and the elusive one that whoever invents it will be a billionaire, I think, a very quick, easy, accurate, repeatable way to monitor stress-free temperature or rail neutral temperature, whatever you call it in your jurisdiction. So let's talk about ultrasonic rail flaw detection. Important thing because in the USA, North American Database, Canada, and FRA combined, rail breaks are about 25% of our relevant database. And I'll group in there the detailed fractures, the TDs, the DFs, the VSHs, and what have you. So it's important to eliminate these as best we can. We have mandated ultrasonic detection requirements for all class 4 and 5 track. That's any speed above 60 miles an hour, basically. And if it's class 3 track and it runs passenger trains, we must have an annual inspection. And it has to be every 40 MGT or once a year, whichever is shorter. And there's another thing here. We only have freight 30 MGT on class 3 lines. The big issue in my part of the world is missing defects, perhaps, due to rolling contact fatigue or rail surface conditions, obscuring the ability of conventional ultrasonic technology to pierce below that stuff and see defects that are lurking under the surface. We've had a number of high-profile derailments in our country where recent test car runs have just been made days or weeks prior to the defect growth. And in those cases, we've had significant rolling contact fatigue on those rails at the point of these flaws. And so there's been a lot of regulatory talk, et cetera, about how we deal with this stuff. And also heavily worn rail sections.
Quick question on that.
Yeah, yeah.
You mean so therefore the flaws were masked by the rolling contact fatigue?
That's the theory. The question was, do I mean that the flaw was masked by the rolling contact fatigue? And that is the current supposition. Now, I'm working on one major derailment, an oil train derailment, where our federal regulatory people claim that the rail flaw detector missed it. But we've been doing a deep dive into the B scans and the data, and simply it picked up the RCF, but there was no flaw there at the time of the detection. So when I say this, I have to be guarded in my comments because the regulators are on top of this, but I'm not sure they're always dealing with a full deck of cards when they start talking, okay? To put it mildly. So, it is a controversial area. But there is some evidence that in some cases, the heavy presence of RCF did mask a defect or certainly created no test zones in certain areas. Another question is how often should we be testing? On some routes, they're testing now every so many weeks. Used to be once or twice a year, but now we're getting the testing intervals spaced closer and closer, and that's been beneficial. The big new technology on the horizon is the concept of phased array ultrasonic testing that improves the reliability of testing under conditions of RCF and heavily worn rail sections. That's where we tended to miss things, and phased array systems show great promise to allow ultrasonics to see beyond those conditions and provide better test results. The good news is that because of this improved testing and improved methods, we have considerably, since 2000, brought the number of rail failure derailments down significantly to an extremely low rate, and we're down between 10 and 12 in 2015, which is a major accomplishment for the amount of tonnage we run in North America on our network, 160,000 miles of track roughly, 1.6 or 7 million wagons. So it's a very busy network, and to get our derailments down below 20 per year is quite an accomplishment, I think. Sperry is one of the leaders in the States and worldwide. They have a new system called X-Fire, which is essentially a version of a phased array that does well on worn rail and RCF. There's a manual walking stick version of one of their systems as well. Herzog is another supplier who is also pushing the phased array system, and with good success, and we, this is what phased array can do, just to summarize it for you in a simple sense, is when you have a heavily worn grass section, some of the beam angles may be deflected or not refracted, and with phased array, what you do, you come along about 2 meters or 1 meter ahead of the rail, you take a profile sample, and then you send that, you feed that information back to the sensors, the probes, and they adjust their beam angles to compensate for the wear in the rail so that you get good coverage of any defect area. So that's the basic concept. Nordco is another supplier as well. Now, track geometry, a very much a legacy system. We probably used that term 412 times in the last 2 days, track geometry recording. Been around a long time. We have all kinds of systems, self-propelled vehicles, pulled cars, high rail mounted vehicles as well. Currently, they're all using GPS pretty much. And we use them to ensure compliance with our 213 track standards, because certain classes of track must be mapped at least once a year by an electronic system. Standard channels, you know those, gauge, crossover, etc. And new systems are measuring, I think, a very important parameter, and that is rail cant. And some are now measuring our rail profile at the same time we measure geometry. Rail cant is the angle, some people call cant is the elevation in the track. When we speak of rail cant, we mean whether that rail is canted outward generally. Sometimes they get canted inward, but off of a perpendicular plane. It's very important in assessing the probability of rollover, railroad derailment. Yes, sir.
Yep. What's the rationale for the regulator insisting that a geometry run is done once a year?
I think just to ensure good, accurate data and not reliance on hand methods, going out with a level board and putting it on like this. I can't claim I was sitting in the room when they came up with the requirements, but you know, it's basically that we know with an electronic system you're going to get a full coverage, you're not going to miss anything, and you're going to establish some quantitative values. Okay.
So it's independent, quantifiable right. Check on the outside.
On top of the twice a week high rail inspections that must be made that presumably check these parameters as well. But I beat that horse to death about when you get human beings out there with tape measures and storms and rain and what have you. Okay, some of the problems we have with geometry systems, especially the laser-based systems, are dropouts caused by sunlight and track features such as turnouts, flangeways, grade crossings, etc. It's been frustrating for me using these channels a lot. You record all this stuff, and then you really drill into it and say, I've got 50 meters of a dropout here, what happened? And sometimes they don't always go back and figure out why they missed a bunch of data. As we have discussed, the emerging technology is to place geometry systems on unattended vehicles to improve productivity and more frequent coverage, resulting in autonomous geometry data collection. That's where we're headed with this stuff. So ENSCO is one of the leaders in rail-mounted geometry systems. They've equipped most of the federal regulators' cars that roam around our system. It's interesting, in the U.S., the Federal Regulatory Agency, FRA, has their own test cars, and they can show up at your door and go, well, we want to run on your railroad today. Give us track time, and they'll run and collect data. They'll share it with you after the run and or write you fines and tickets for violations that they find. So it's sort of a cash cow for them, I think. It's like setting up a speed zone on the highway, you know? I'm just kidding. They have good intent, but they will be happy to write a fine if they find it. Andean Technology, Canadian group that's been around a long time and was active in the early development of many of the geometry systems, have devised a few high rail mounted systems. And railroads like these, rather than the big heavy rail cars that take track time and operators and all this stuff, a high rail truck that can be equipped with a geometry system. Some people say, well, it's not getting a load on the track, but some people say, well, it's better than nothing. You know, it's the old saying, I'd rather light a candle than to curse the darkness, okay? So if you can put a geometry system on a high rail truck that once a week rides the territory and you start to see trending and things, that's just as valuable as a heavily weighted rail-bound type system, I think. So they're doing some good work. They've have systems around the world on standard gauge, narrow gauge, wide gauge, broad gauge, etc. Harsco is one of the other leaders of self-propelled vehicles, as is Placer. I think it's German or Austrian. And Mermac has been out there with systems for many, many years as well. And Trimble is another group that makes sort of a portable profiling system if you want to go that route for a short line or something. Now, I won't talk about the IRC cars. I think IOC cars that Graham discovered, you've seen those, but I will mention that ENSCO has developed a system that can be mounted on a passenger or freight vehicle to provide autonomous geometry collection. Again, it's laser-based. I don't know how well things like that would work in dusty environments like the Pomara region up there, but they've had some success on the passenger systems with these type of systems. They've got about 10 currently in operation in the U.S., one in Australia, I'm not sure where it is, and one in Brazil. About two-thirds are freight applications and about a third are passenger. So the automated track geometry system, here you see it mounted on a freight wagon, is out there running around. They do find defects within 5 minutes. They email alert maintenance personnel, and they're going to add in the near future rail profile and machine vision to this system to look at sleepers and fasteners and bolts and nuts, things of that nature. VTI has been mentioned several times in this session, I think, and yesterday or last evening. It's basically a package of accelerometers that are typically mounted on a locomotive, and you capture acceleration data. So it's not quite as good as an IRV, but it's giving you the reaction of a locomotive vehicle to track anomalies, especially in the vertical direction kind of things, as well as lateral. The typical things they measure are car body accelerations, shown here, which is valuable for longer wavelength geometry things. And then they also look at axle accelerations that are good for picking up impacts, battered joints, broken frogs, things like that on the rail level. Also, car body lateral, looking for lateral excursions, and they do big chord offset as well with their automated system. They also have pioneered a concept that was presented at the Heavy Hall in Perth a year and a half ago, where they're looking at combo clusters of defects, such as mid-chord offset defects, axle accelerations, car body values, car body verticals. And when they see combos of something occurring at a certain spot, they have automated algorithms now to flag those for priority maintenance, which is a good thing. What we learned with some of the VTI experiments out there is that the axle accelerations have been the most valuable data to detect bad joints and battered frogs, etc. Geometry cars may be better picking up the longer wavelength stuff, and the car body accelerations are, as I said, better at the longer wavelength kinds of things. VTI folks will admit, or be the first to admit, that using VTI data in concert with geometry data is a very good combination of systems to give you a total picture of how vehicles are responding on top of the track that you're measuring. Sort of like what Graham just showed you with the IRV car, where you overlaid the, okay, here's the geometry, here's the vehicle response. You could do that if you combine the VTI with the geometry data. A new application one railroad is looking at with VTI is to put an inclinometer, or maybe it's a rate sensor on there, where they can get twist and cross level as well out of the VTI. And as some people mentioned, power and communications is never a real problem when you mount stuff on a locomotive. And that's where most of these VTI packages have gone. There's the IRC. I don't need to talk about that. We've been through that territory. So autonomous geometry, it is a wave of the future. No question about it. We get frequent inspections. You can use it in risk assessment models, as I suggested this morning. Maintenance is always an issue with these cars. I think somebody brought that up here. You put these things out there, it's a rough environment, dust, dirt, grease, dry weather. You're going to have broken belts on alternators. You're going to have sensors break off, cables get sliced. So you got to be out there and prepared to take care of them. I'm not saying you put out an IRV and it's going to run for 10 years unattended. Okay, that's a misnomer. As we mentioned, power can be an issue. And if you are going to equip a fleet, just don't put one out there, because you're going to have breakdowns, you're going to have comm losses, you're going to have low battery voltage, you have a broken solar panel or snow on a solar panel perhaps, and lose power. So if you're going to put something in a fleet, put, depending on the size of your fleet, put enough in there that you can sustain a failure rate and still get good data and get good reliability on your data acquisition. GRMS, I asked you this morning if you use much of that down here. You said no, so I won't really spend a lot of time on it, but simply what it is, it's a vehicle either rail-bound or truck-bound. It goes down the track with a middle axle that continually spreads the gauge with anywhere from 3 kips on lightweight trucks to up to 10 or 12 kips in a lateral direction and measuring the delta gauge or the change from unloaded to loaded gauge. They can predict areas of weak ties and plan tie replacement programs and catch, obviously, regulatory gauge defects that way.
I understand they've been used very successfully for quite some period of time in the States.
Yes, very successfully.
A lot of them running around.
There's about 10 or 11 of them running around in continuous operation.
And everyone would only be doing that if they were getting great value out of them.
Oh, they're getting great value.
Yeah.
People
and,
like
and yet,
they'll wood tie track primarily, yeah. Not concrete so much.
And yet we don't have a single one in this country.
Well, you got a lot of concrete down here.
A lot of hardwood,
a lot of softwood. Yeah. Softwood is, that's a good place to put GRMS on softwood. Not a big fan of softwood. You're just making a point.
I'm just making a point.
I don't know why you don't have them. They're in South America. I think Brazil's got several running around. People like them. They give you geometry. They now give you machine vision for tire sleeper assessment. They're giving you rail profile. They're giving you rail camp. So Holly has a nice package, okay? It gives you everything. So if you run the truck, you're getting your geometry run, you're getting your tie condition, you're getting your delta gauge, and everything else. I've worked with this data, and I'm a big believer in it. It's good stuff. So just to show you, here's the Holland, this is the 800 series big truck. One of the drawbacks that railroads give a little pushback on, this requires a CDL license. It requires two people to operate it. It's a big piece of equipment. So some railroads have kind of pushed it to the side because of the labor requirements again. As I said, it's been used, tested over 500 or half a million miles in the past 10 years. There's roughly 10 or 11 vehicles running around. 200 railroads, transits, and industrial operations have used this technology. You can cover about 100 miles a day. As I said, you also get geometry profile and vision assessment. Now, they've come up with, that was the 400 series. They now have what's called the 850. It's a middleweight platform with light loading capabilities. It only gives you about 3 kips lateral, 2 kips vertical, but it also can provide a world of information. Now, people are liking this because of, the 850 they're liking because it does not require a CDL driver. It's a much lighter vehicle, one-man operation, and so again, your labor costs are significantly less, your reliability issues are less, and it's still giving you a lot of very good information. Okay, and the Federal Railroad cars do have ENSCO GRMS systems put on those. This is a rail-bound platform, not trucks. Oops. And these things run around our country doing the same thing. And here's a portable system as well that's been developed. I use this type of system when I'm doing a spot check at a derailment. We don't have time to bring a big system out there. So these little portable systems, mine provide about 5 kips lateral. And you can really spread the gauge with 5 kips if you've got weak tie conditions. So what we have learned about GRMS is it's an excellent method to evaluate track strength. Objectively, it's probably more valuable on wooden sleepers than concrete. Takes the guesswork out. As I said, the Holland 400 requires 2 people and a CDL, so that's kind of, you get some pushback at the big railroads on it. The Holland system is using the new Vista geometry to create the rail profile measurement and geometry. Vista, for those of you who follow this, it's kind of interesting. A guy named Reeves, that's his first name, Ed Reeves, in South Carolina, invented one of the first laser-based geometry systems. It was called Reeves system, whatever. He sold that to ImageMap. ImageMap. And they got sold to Mermec. And so now Reeves, everybody thought he was going to retire. He comes out now. He's got a new So it's interesting how these innovations keep coming at us from the people that work on. Slide detectors have been around for many years. Slide fences find falling rocks, avalanches and things. It's usually integrated in the signal system. And we also have seismic testing devices now that can pick up earthquakes and things. We've all seen slide fences in the canyon areas to pick up rock slides and what have you. This thing I presented last night very quickly caught my eye, kind of been on the periphery of some of the development of it. The ballast integrity sensor system, it can measure very slight movements in the ballast section. So it can pick up things like incipient track buckles, slides, washouts, headwall movements around bridges, things of that nature. It's kind of ingenious. You put it in the ballast, and it's solar powered. You can network 5 or 10 of these together in a maybe a high risk area, and pick up things like slides, washouts, something that is god awful as that, and you can chain these together with obvious Wi-Fi and telegraphic communication capabilities. This is an interesting chart I picked up. In North America, 50% of bridge-related train stops are related to highway vehicles striking bridge abutments, bridge walls, bridge structure, etc., knocking it out of alignment. And we had a very famous derailment in Alabama back in 92, one of the worst I ever went to in terms of fatalities. About 50 people died when a barge struck a rail bridge in the middle of the night in fog. Didn't know what he hit, he backed up and went another way, and then about an hour later, Amtrak came along, or passed along a distance passenger operator, hit it at 79 miles an hour, and the thing went airborne in the mud. The nose of that engine was, they called it the mud missile, it dug in about 30 feet deep, killed the crew, obviously. So, barge strikes and highway strikes often move our bridges out of position, so it's not a high-cost system to give you a measure of protection there, these things called the ballast integrity sensor. Speaking of ballast, Georgetown Rail has a system called Ballast Saver. It's a mapping system using lasers to assess ballast quality. You can run it down the track before you're going to do maintenance with timber surfacing, etc., and it will look at your shoulders, your cribs, and calculate how much ballast you need. And then it has software to feed it into their ballast gate system to automatically drop the prescribed amount of ballast and where you need it to get your ballast back to the nominal conditions. Another innovative tool from Georgetown Rail. Rail friction measurements are important in assessing wheel climb potential, rail rollover potential, and general rail life assessment, and keeping our rails living as long as they can. Commonly, we call these things turbometers. They were developed in the late 80s, most of them. We have some couple high rail mounted systems that have come out in the last 10 years. And they measure coefficient of friction on the top of the rail and the gauge face of the rail. That's the basic idea of these systems, to eliminate guesswork and subjectivity. However, I've always told people, I say there are two ways to measure friction. One is you buy a turbometer. It's about $20,000. Okay? The others go down to, do you have Walmarts down here? Kmart's or something like that. Go down to a big box store. Buy a pair of white cotton gloves for about $1.29. And here's my technique. Put the glove on, swipe your finger. If it's dark, okay, you're probably at a 0.1 to 0.2 coefficient of friction. If it's light gray, you're probably 0.3 to 0.4. And if it's white, you're probably 0.5 or above. Okay? So you can use the $1.29 Gary method or the $20,000 method. I just know this because I've rolled that damn thermometer so many times. I kind of know what I'm looking for by having the advantage of measuring it with an agrotripometer and then seeing what it looks like with my finger. When you're measuring friction, you're just trying to get in the ballpark. So here's the old thing here. It looked like a vacuum cleaner, heavy as hell. We got dirty. Pushed it along the rail, and it worked. It was good, best we had. Here's one of the rail-mounted systems that is a high-speed version, I think up to 30 miles per hour. And then we have a new innovation, again, by the guy who invented the first one 80 or 30 years ago, Harold Harrison, has come out with a new version that you see in this picture. There's about 8 or 10 of them out there, I think. It has a little motorized wheel in here. It sits on the rail with magnets, and it moves down here. And what it does, it replicates what an instrumented wheel set would do, in that it measures longitudinal, lateral, and what have you, creep forces, your longitudinal, lateral creep forces. And through that assessment, it comes up with coefficient of friction. Pretty slick method. And they're working on a high-speed version that can be mounted on a truck or something. So, again, we're pushing the envelope forward on tribology measurements. GPR, ground penetrating radar. Not too many people use these, but I've seen some good results with them. If you really have subgrade issues, you don't know what's under there, it's a good technique. The people who have used it have been pretty happy in terms of marking the underneath of the track. Here's a system from Europe called the LGA system, and they say it can go up to 120 kilometers an hour with these big antennas and things. I guess they're right. This is one that was used in North America with the ARM company. It's an Italian group, IDS, and again, it provides an underground mapping of your subsurface conditions, where your boundary layers are between ballast, subgrade, and your clays and things like that. And it finds, you know, culverts and water pockets, what have you. Automated sleeper inspection, real exciting technology using machine vision. To go down the railroad, look at every sleeper, automatically give it a grade or a quality grading, say whether it needs replacement or not. Good stuff, used for asset management. And combining it with GRMS data gives you a comprehensive assessment of your lateral track strength. The systems are currently high rub truck mounted. And it also, they have an automatic concrete tie seat abrasion model that meets the mandated automated inspection by our regulatory agency. As we talked about, human inspection is subject to normal bias. They did a number of studies when this was being validated out at TTCI, where they have a human walk one way, he's safe, and he's checking or she's checking eyes. And when that person would turn around and walk the other way, they'd find 70% differential, or only achieve a 70% repeatability level, depending on direction. So that just tells you the subjectivity of human beings. These systems have achieved 90%+ agreement with human inspections. As I've said many times, it's not subject to being fatigued or physical well-being, etc. And most railroads run these every 1 to 4 years to get a sleeper assessment. It was invented in 2003, so again, it's not a cutting-edge technology, but not everybody's using it yet. But it's been around almost 15 years, and it's showing tremendous promise. You can collect data at up to 30 miles an hour with these systems, and picks up all this stuff. It'll measure every fastener. The precision and repeatability was measured at 97% with multiple tests at TTCI. So again, it's highly validated and it works. So what it does is take an extra kind of a picture, a machine vision picture of your fasteners here. It has automated algorithms, which I've told you about. That's what railroads want. They don't want to look at this squiggly line. They just want to be told that, hey, you have a fastener down here that's backed off 0.3 inch or what have you, or a missing fastener. Give me answers, not data. They also have developed a backscatter X-ray system called XI. Is there a trademark for it? It's sticks out of the back of a high rail truck. And what it does is it looks internally at sleeper condition. Wooden sleepers, again, not valuable for concrete. But this is kind of interesting. If I walked along and saw that sleeper, I'd say, yeah, it's got another 10 years, right? Well, the X-ray says, no, it didn't, and they cut it open, and look, just totally hollow shell in there with rot and bugs and what have you. So another interesting sample here, you know, look at these sleepers. Yeah, I'd disqualify that guy, but I'd probably say he's okay, that's okay, that's okay. But then X-ray tagged all these. They drilled test holes and found hollow spots and rot and what have you in the center. So another very good tool to really get below the surface. INSCO has some machine vision systems to image joint bars and rail batter at joints and things. And that's called the JBIS system, high rail mounted again. And Holland also has machine vision assessment on their trucks. So to conclude, machine vision has moved from experimental to full commercial viability. It's not a rocket science anymore. I think they've got 7 or 8 trucks running around doing this. It's shown excellent repeatability and consistency, removes personal bias, been validated against human inspectors. And with X-ray, you can even see inside the sleepers to really, quote, get beneath the surface. Track deflection method measurement. What time, Robbie, am I supposed to be off? I'm still on Eastern Standard Time.
3:15.
I got 10 more minutes left. Okay. Yes. I think we'll finish up.
6 minutes.
6 minutes, all right. This is a technology. I gave you a disclaimer earlier that I'm not backing anything, but this is one technology I was personally involved with, and I met a professor at a university who had developed a system for track deflection, and he just patented it. And long story short, we formed a relationship, and we started helping him market and test and validate the results of this system. And so I've been around, I haven't been dealing with it for 6 or 7 years, but I was very impressed with what it can find. I did some testing with it, and what it does is it measures track deflection, okay? Now, this red box here, conventional track geometry systems do not accurately measure track deflection. Now, we can spend 20 or 30 minutes, and I convince you of this, I don't have time, but take it from me. You think, you know, when we tell a railroad this measures track deflection, the first response is, hey, I get this with my geometry car. I go, no, you don't. If you get space curve data, you don't get deflection. Big difference. And I have a half hour or 45 minute presentation on the difference of these measurement systems, but it does work, and it gives you the true deflection under load of what the rail is doing. So it's very valuable for identifying broken ties, and broken rails. It has pinpointed some of the early testing. It predicted the exact site to within 5 inches of where 2 rail breaks occurred because the deflection was high at those locations. And this morning I said, we've now correlated where you have heavy rail bending going on with poor subgrade support and high deflections, you have the chance of developing fractures. So it's found those. It's called MRAIL, was the patented name of it. It's now handled by Harscope, a large track company worldwide that is handling all the marketing and deployment of it, maintenance of it. But it is also an autonomous data collection system. It's set up to run on a revenue vehicle, a loaded vehicle, hopefully. Here we show the first car we built, and uses lasers to do this work, but it finds broken welds, vertical dynamic action, track buckle conditions, poor ride quality, etc. And as I said, it, by the way it works, it does measure true deflection called Y-rail, and it does not just, which geometry systems miss. Now, some innovative uses of this, TTCI did a major study a few years ago and used it to detect weak stringers in wooden trusses. At TTCI, they have a test bridge where they can take stringers out, push stringers in, but they use the MRAIL to see if it can assess the soundness of bridge structural support. So they ran test one with all good stringers. In test two, they took out the left-hand stringer here and weakened it considerably. In test three, they did both of them, and the results were pretty impressive. I won't bore you with the details, but on test one, with good stringers, the deflections were relatively consistent. When they took out one stringer here, bingo, the deflection went up on that side and remained normal on the other side. And in test three, where they weakened both stringers, both deflections went up in response. And it was very accurate and repeatable at finding the locations of the stringers. Now, these are TTCI's words, not mine, but it said only the MRAIL system was capable of accurately detecting which stringer was weaker. It has the biggest potential to be used in an unmanned autonomous revenue service again to evaluate bridge strength. Now, they also looked at geometry as well, and it picked up general conditions, but geometry alone could not tell you which stringer was weaker than the other. So that was pretty successful. It also showed that it was not speed dependent. You got the same results at 10, 20, 30, or 40 miles an hour. Here's another project by a fellow named Dr. Michael Hendry of University of Alberta here. He's done some very good seminal research on track structure and track support. And this was one example, and he used the MREL data to support his research. And I've been fascinated reading some of his papers if you go on the internet. He's really moving the ball forward on track support issues. But they surveyed this track section here in this red area was a very soft area of the track, high deflection area. They went in and undercut and remediated the entire, I don't know, 500 or 800 meters or whatever it was, of track, and dug down to the clay subgrade ballast, removed all the ballast, and came in with new ballast. And in some sections they put, I believe it was tensor geogrid down, and to test the effectiveness of that. And so they had this test section here, and this is a mapping of how deep they had to dig, 1.6 meters in some places. And they went back with compacted fill, sub-ballast, and ballast. And in these sections, they put geogrid down as well. And when they ran the comparisons from, in red here is 2012, before they did the remediation, and then the blue or purple is 2014, 2 years later, after they remediated this section in here. And you see the high variability, the high deflections going on. And then after they remediated, it really settled down. It became a very good, smooth track section. This shows the results again. These are the 2012 values, and these are the 2014 values in dark gray. You see the tremendous improvement in red deflection. And these are the geogrid areas here that showed some of the most improvement over the ungeogridded area. So it was good to develop a methodology for assembling multiple runs of data. It showed the level of improvements and in cases where the remediation was not carried out well. And again, this is Dr. Hendry, not me. He said this could not be done with track geometry data available. Quote, unquote, we tried. It would need to wait and monitor for years, and the results may still be obscured by routine maintenance. So when we're talking about track deflection, we're not talking about the window dressing we do when we do a little fluffing with tamping and things. We're talking about the true support of the track. And I better shut up now. I got a few other things here. Let's see if there's anything else of breakthrough importance. This is all, you'll have all this stuff. Internal rev stress monitoring. I guess this is the final one. This is for safe, stress re-temperature. There's been numerous attempts to come up with ways to monitor rail, neutral, or stress-free temperature. And you see one here, the Vortok multi-sensor method. And you install, I think this is on, I don't know if this is the RPC or who. You see a Pac National guy there. And multi-sensor is a plug, kind of a bolt that you stick in a hole. I shouldn't call it a bolt, it's really not threaded. But you drill a certain diameter hole, you bang it in with a wooden hammer type deal, and it has embedded in it strain technology to measure vertical shear, horizontal strain, the core temperature, vibration, and acceleration. You embed it in the rail, and they allege it's a simple insertion process. And this shows the rail drilling, and you put it in the hole. So they're using this for their wheel check, wheel impact detector, as well as monitoring the stress-free rail. Now, I will mention, I'm aware down here in Australia, some people have had trouble with these devices. Don't know all the details, so I would urge you caution before you jump into this. Check it out. But they tell me these things last roughly 10 years would be the typical failure rate. So it's a very simple system versus strain gauging rails, which is very costly and time-consuming. There are methods that do that. The Quinetic Q method, where they use a strain sensor mounted to the web of the rail and they daisy chain it into a communication network to cover larger areas. Some of the things we've learned with rail stress, though, is that it's a static. You can do it statically with VERSE, and many of you are used to the VERSE system. If some of you in the room use VERSE, know what it is, how it works. Done lots of VERSE testing. It's cumbersome, but it's accurate, damn good accuracy. But it only records one spot in the track. These monitoring systems using strain has been a expensive experiment. It's not always precise. It's very site dependent. There's been other attempts using Barkhausen noise, guided waves, and other systems that have not proven to be feasible. We're still searching for the magic bullet here. So you young people in the audience, you want a challenge, come out with a way of going down the track at 40 kilometers an hour and monitoring stress-free temperature, you'll be a billionaire. Right there. Okay. I think that's all I got. Took a minute or two, well, 1 minute later, but the rest of those will be in your presentation where you'll get it, some of the other coverages, but shows you the depth and breadth of what we got out there now, kind of hopefully whets your appetite to explore some of these options and, you know, buyer beware, okay? You want to check it out. Thank you.
So we're straight on into the next one, which is growing again. Speaking this time about utilization of data for new technologies to improve track condition and land use planning.
Thank you. Yeah, this really flows on from where we were half an hour ago, three quarters of an hour ago. So I introduced the topic of, hang on, you haven't finished. You want me to talk to him as well? Okay, all right, no. This looks more like mine. Yeah, I introduced the instrumented revenue vehicles before and basically talked about what they collect and started to introduce some of the ways we looked at the data. In this case, I want to take it to the next level where we can actually show some real examples of how this data is now being used and tailored to specific organisations and to help them convert this massive of data into the usable information that railways require. Are we there yet? Absolutely not. Yeah. Can we do things better? Yes. But we've progressed a long, long way. The first thing about the instrumented wagons is that they are autonomous, they're fully automated, they basically download automatically, they get processed, the data gets processed automatically, gets fed into databases, noise removal occurs, reports are generated, some of these reports are sent directly to our customers for immediate actions. The data, as I say, is put away into databases as well to allow us to do the longer-term trending of you know, effectiveness of maintenance and so on. So it is pretty much a fully automated system these days. We have one chap whose job it is to basically monitor the fleet, the health of the fleet, and Bill made the point before about managing them and making sure how important that is in terms of performance. His job is very much, if I go and ask him, what's the condition of such and such, he will just basically tell me there and then. So, as I say, the downloads and everything else are automated. How is the information used? One of the principal things that the railway systems like about these, the instrumented wagons is the immediacy of the data. We mentioned before about E1 defects from a track recording car having to stop before the next train comes along, which is once every, we record once every 4 months. In this case, we can get near real-time feedback on the condition of your asset to the point where we're in 3G or 4G network coverage. These reports are sent back to Monash and literally can be out within the businesses within 10 or 15 minutes. What they do is they provide all of the information about where you are. Various areas have obviously been blanked out to protect the not quite so innocent. If anyone recognises that piece of track. what this one is actually showing is things like the speed that the train was going. So you've got probably 300 or 400 metres worth of track down the bottom, maybe a bit more. So the speed that the train was going, the in-train forces. So one of the things you have to be very wary of is if you get a major run-in, you'll often see a large response in your suspension. So you have to make sure that if you're reporting a high, what appears to be elevated response out of the bogie or a high load, to make sure that it wasn't driver initiated. This is a very clear-cut case. This is actually the acceleration data from the side frames, so there's not too much in that, not much was going on. This is the side frame suspension travel. You can see it's quite active, a quite active piece of high response. We then process the data from that both across, well, effectively across the bogey to work out whether the wagon is perceiving an in-phase response, so like a wagon bounce that you'd often see if you hit a level crossing or a bridge or something, so the wagon goes into a bounce mode, or we subtract across the bogey to see whether the body is hunting, swaying, rocking, whatever you choose to call it. What you can see is that there's a very strong out-of-phase response here, and we know that this type of response can lead to derailments. They have in the past. And so where we see that information, we've got predefined limits, and in some cases that information will be sent directly back to Conmon teams within the businesses. First thing that effectively happens is a speed restriction will be applied to that location. Obviously, you work with each individual customer, tailor these reports for them and however they want to respond, but clearly there is a huge benefit in this type of information in terms of the immediacy and taking the guesswork out of, you know, or the human element out of making the decisions about the condition of the track. More recently, we're effectively doing exactly the same thing, but in this case, we're now looking at passenger comfort, continuously monitoring of passenger ride, using things like the Australian standard for, you know, it's about a 10-second window, you're looking at the ride over, breaking the responses up into the different frequency bands as per the standard, and effectively giving over each sort of 10 seconds the passenger comfort. Clearly that's a pretty topical piece of information these days. But at the same time, we also provide the vehicle response data in terms of what's happening at the suspension, what the bolster's actually doing or bogey, you know, is it steering badly? So you can then start to understand why the high or poor ride condition or how track condition might be feeding into that, into the passenger ride. This is stuff we've really only been starting in the last month or two. Another one that's highly topical is the ability to detect a track buckle. Again, this is relatively new information, but one of the things we're doing is continuously monitoring the tracking of the bogey, so the ability for the bogey to steer. This is an example where effectively monitoring the steer rate of the bogey over time, and there was this sudden change of, you know, over the course of a few days, the steer rate of that particular bogey. This was post a derailment event, but clearly there was some indication if we had been at that stage monitoring this. So we're now starting to think this is a really powerful tool that one can start to use to understand whether a location is prone to derailment. So one of the things that we're looking to improve the analysis is, you know, are there locations on track where the steer of the wagon is sensitive to the time of day or the temperature of the rail? So is there some inkling that there's a weak spot in the track? Again, it is relatively early days, but clearly continuously monitoring something like the bogey tracking or the steer rate of the bogey might be a defence, again, many a disclaimer, about the ability to pick up a buckle, track buckle location. Railway systems like to know where their trouble spots are. No one from the Hunter Valley here, I think. There's an example where, because all the data is continuously being put into databases, we have the ability to start mapping locations which are problematic. Now, they could be, you know, based on vehicle ride, they could be suspension, they could be side frame acceleration. Any of those you can start to put into, you know, heat maps so that the track owner can get a very quick sense of where they need to be targeting their maintenance. One of the primary ways in which the data is provided to the customers is through dashboards. Sitting behind these dashboards are the large databases. Effectively, all of the information we receive is broken down. At the moment, we break all the information up into 50-metre blocks, 50-metre track segments, and we can then start to trend on that those pieces of track. So the sorts of information that could be contained are things like each individual section, how is that section deteriorating over time? You can look at individual runs to have a look at, you know, which track was I actually travelling down? What was the response? You know, so you've got track location on the bottom axis, speeds, which track, speed, and what were the responses? Do I have any responses on the track that are exceeding the threshold? You can have a look at effectively KPIs. So how over a period of time are we tracking in terms of severity 1 or severity 2 or severity 3 defects? These are tailored to the requirements of the individual customers. The other thing is we actually work not directly with Ramses, but for instance, we extract data out of Ramses and we do things like track maintenance plans and feed that information back into Ramses for the individual railways to make decisions about the sort of 6 to 14 week maintenance plans by trending this information. I'll show you some examples. In the case of Vale, we were working closely with the data map product. One of the key things that, or key utilisation, I guess, of IAC data is obviously you want to make sure you can protect your asset. And the key way of doing that, if you're seeing high vehicle dynamics, is to slow the train down. So one of the immediate responses when there's a high dynamic action is to impose a speed restriction. That's one of the first actions before you talk to a track inspector, just basically slow the next train down. But the other thing that you get out of, just move to the next slide. This just shows, for example, this is speed, this is dynamic response. You can see it's reasonably steep. You know, this is for three-piece bogies. Obviously, each type of wagon might be different. Certain classes of wagon are slightly different. But what we generally find is that by the time you knock something down to about 60 kilometres an hour, a lot of the vehicle dynamics, again, for three-piece bogies, have been taken out. The energy's taken out. We find that sort of 9 times out of 10, getting down to 60 will be enough to get you away from a severity 1 issue. Now, I know a lot of railway systems will impose speed restrictions that are probably dramatically below that, 20s, 40s, these sorts of numbers based on what be the experience of the inspector who's gone out. But the question really is it necessary to go to those low speeds? So one of the advantages of an instrumented wagon is it can provide how effective a speed restriction may have been. So, you know, here, for instance, here's the response at 72. Another IAC came through at 60, a lot of the response, comes through at 40. You know, you've knocked out pretty much all of the dynamic response in this case. So you can normally our first step is we impose a 60. If the next train still comes through, we'll drop it down to 50. Rarely would you need to go much further. So again, it's a very good way of, I guess, as the title says, taking the guesswork out of how you actually apply a temporary speed restriction. We talk about track deterioration and the need for maintenance. This is one of our dashboards. This effectively shows about 5 months worth of data in terms of dynamic vehicle response. This was the track speed. This is how the response varies with speed. What you can see is that generally the track had been reasonably stable. There was a few higher responses there, but it had settled down again. But then, just in early January, this location took off, and over a two-week period went from what had been relatively stable track to effectively what we'd refer to as a severity 1 limit. Happens really quickly. one of the key drivers for it, obviously up in the Pilbara and just about any railway system, is if you get heavy rainfall, you'll find locations. Again, will track geometry cars be able to be out there regularly enough to pick up these deterioration rates? Now, if you're out there once a month, maybe, but literally over 2 weeks, you'd gone from what you consider good track to something where you had to impose a speed restriction. You can actually see that a speed restriction was imposed at this point and knocked out the response. I'm not sure whether that location, it's probably subsequently been tamped, but in fact, no, it probably hasn't, because the speed restriction, and this would only be a few days ago, is still in place. Again, it really does, and as long as you've got the right tools in place so that you don't have to trawl through every one of these locations as an end user to say, oh, Jesus, that one's interesting. You've got the filters in place to show me locations that are suddenly changing in their attributes or their deterioration, then I think it provides a very powerful and consistent tool for being able to monitor track condition. Maintenance planning. Again, QR are doing it using geometry degradation. A lot of it's done based on probably exceedance of severity limits based on out of track recording cars. But in terms of a lot of that might be, well, certainly the latter case will be the reactive maintenance. Okay, we've hit an E1 or a severity one. We slow a train down and we put in place corrective actions. What we need to do is be better at it. Here's a really good example, and I did choose this one specifically. This shows another location similar to the one before, but you can see that over a long time, and that's from February 2016 to current, the response over a 50 metre section of track. You can see that it's basically been deteriorating. Now, one of the criticisms of IOC data is, geez, there's a lot of scatter in that data. And yes, there is. Many a reason. Some of it's related to speed. We're measuring a dynamic response. If the train goes through slower, you'll get lower responses. We've got different wagon classes with different suspension characteristics. They're all lumped in there as well. I think Gary made the point that, when you put a new wagon out there, day one, it's as good as it's going to be. Over time, it's going to wear. The profiles will wear. The way it reacts to the geometry will differ. So, yes, there is variability in responses, but if you look past all of that, and this is the challenge for, I suppose, we as someone who might be trying to sell this technology or to get the railway to implement this technology, is how do we distill that information down to something that you guys can use? And that's the most important thing. Because what you really don't want, the thing is, you don't want to be hitting severity one. The way that we view it, severity one is you normally put a speed restriction on. One of the key drivers that we're aiming towards is zero severity ones. What we want to do is tell you where they're going to be before they happen so you don't have speed restriction. So you can go in there and do the maintenance that's necessary to fix the piece of track. In this case, maintenance occurred, highly effective, and your track is back into top-notch condition. The case we looked at before, we could see that it had been tracking along in very good condition for a long period of time, but then something changed and it deteriorated very rapidly and you needed to be quite responsive to be able to get to that location. So what we're thinking, or what the way that we're viewing this data is that it really is going to provide a very powerful means by which we can start to do some of the stuff that I think as railroads we ought to be able to do, the predictive maintenance and the like. This is just another way of viewing the data. This is about a kilometre's worth of track here, and this is the recordings. It's about 170 recordings. It could have been over, say, 6 months. This is the response at a particular location. The darker the colour, effectively the higher response. I guess before we had these current dashboards, this is how we'd look at it. We could see that this track location here was showing high rates of, not deterioration, but just highly active wagon. We put a speed restriction on, knocked the response out. Maintenance occurred and the track location has been stable ever since. So again, it's being able to, you know, we're able to assess how effective maintenance has been in many cases. I've probably got the slide a little bit later, which is a bit scary in terms of how effective maintenance actually is. That information I've been talking about has been very much about the long wavelength geometry or responses of the wagon. So it's the suspension travel reacting to roll modes, bounce modes, long wavelength alignment, surface type errors. This provides exactly the same information on the running surface of the rail. This is actually the side frame accelerations over time through a curve. You can see that how the accelerations are deteriorating. A grinding campaign goes in and knocks the high frequency response out of the track. So you can see very clearly how effective your grind has been in controlling that piece of track. So not only is it really providing you some guidance about tamping and lining, but you can see when you ought to be grinding track and how effective your grinder has been at cleaning up that bit of track. This was another example from probably 12 or 13 years ago, just after we first introduced the IOC. This was one area in the heavy haul, one railroad, which still had corrugations. I mean, they're not that prevalent up there anymore. But again, this was showing the side frame accelerations over time. Each of those red vertical lines is the grinder going through to fix or clean up the corrugation. So you can see how effective you are in repairing corrugation. So yes, your ability to detect corrugations is really strong with this type of technology, and also your effectiveness in maintenance is also, it gives you a very good indication of that as well.
Is it an optical illusion, or is the blue linear regression through each of those sections getting steeper as it goes from left to right?
2004? I can't quite remember.
the blue line is a regression through those
points. Yeah.
Is it getting steeper? Is the rate of deterioration, the rate of growth accelerating?
Whether it is or where...
Is it, or is that just optical illusion?
Don't know. We'll come back to you. Okay. The other thing you might need to take in... is that this is time-based and not necessarily tonnage-based. Anyway, move on. We'll run out of time. Now, this is what we were talking about, trending the deterioration. So what we need to do is be able to give you guys some useful information out of these things. So one of the things we want to be able to do is trend this information. What we want to avoid is getting to a severity one. So what we want is the maintenance intervention limits. At what point should we step into that piece of track and say, okay, now is the time to maintain it? And as long as we can give you guys enough warning, and whatever that may be, we need to understand what that might be. How confident are we in predicting those deterioration rates forward so that we can start to introduce or give you this information for a maintenance planning? As I say, this is what we were trying to do in 30 years ago. I think we're probably a lot closer to being able to do it now. So same sort of thing. What we want to do is provide, effectively a surface and line prediction, and say this is what we're doing for one of the customers, and effectively giving 6 to 14 weeks advance notice of the areas that we think are being flagged from a deterioration perspective for maintenance plans. Maintenance effectiveness. This is the results we've got from one of the our sets of data. Because you're collecting so much information or so much data, you can really start to assess whether your maintenance has been effective or not. We find that quite a startling slide. And there's a lot of different ways of defining how effective maintenance has been. But in effect, what we're saying is that 35% of tamping and lining really hasn't given you the benefits that you wanted, or in some cases have taken you backwards. So why have you gone to those locations to tamp them in the first place? Have they tamped the right location? I don't know, is the tamping machine in reasonable nick? But you know, when you consider how much money or how much it costs to tamp and line, you really want to be making sure that it's going to locations where it can be effective. And we know there's lots of locations where it's simply a band-aid solution that you know, other things should be done to that section of track to really get it right. And I think Gary alluded to some of those just before. Yeah, it's a startling number, and I think it's probably a very useful number for railway systems to know. And, you know, you then drill down and have a look at why weren't we effective at these locations. Okay, we're just about done. So just sort of summarising the last sort of 90 minutes of presentation. So track geometry data is currently the preferred means of assessing the condition of track. And we've highlighted, I guess, several issues along the way, whether it's the frequency of measurements and the uncertain relationships between the measured parameters and vehicle response and damage. Continuous monitoring of the railway system, well, condition is valuable, as it will improve, you know, what I would hope that it will improve maintenance planning. It also reduces the number of interventions that you need to come in with, sort of at the highest severity one levels. Instrumented revenue vehicles are an effective tool to quantify vehicle track interaction, if we think that's an important thing to be measuring. So, you know, need to determine, is there a place appetite for continuously monitored track condition data across railroad networks? How can this data be used, integrated into existing systems? From a regulatory perspective, how do these new technologies become an accepted means for track assessment? And I think that's where I stop. Thank you.
Thanks, Graham. Okay, we're up for afternoon tea, so 10 minutes, and back before the conference.
I think the next session is an important one, so please be back at 4 o'clock. Yeah, you can do that. contact with that part.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
We'll walk.
Yeah,
just,
yeah.
Just,
yeah.
Just,
yeah.
Just,
yeah.
Just,
yeah.
Just,
yeah. tell me, when you put the units on monitoring, you've got a lot of pet monitoring. Does the company put it on? Fund that, or do you fund that?
Well, it's 12.
Australia of us all, spoke about recording track geometry data and running simulated vehicles over it, correct?
Yes.
And you'd imagine in a perfect world, you can have a big bank of computers all running in parallel, and every different vehicle that runs across your network would be simulated across that track that you've just recorded. And in even more perfect world, you could do that in real time. You'd feed straight out of the track geometry car, straight into this bank of computers, and do this analysis in real time, potentially, if there was a need for it. Graham spoke to us about the benefits of knowing how a vehicle responds, and about predicting how a vehicle responds, and extrapolating from its current response into the future. You'd also be fair to say that you could, that the system of Ramses at the moment could record track geometry, and with numerous runs of track geometry, could put it together and make a prediction about what the rate of change is for any one site. Would that be fair enough?
Geometry?
Track geometry? You could.
Yes, it can.
You could.
Absolutely, whether it's a meaningful number.
Yeah. So
it comes out, it doesn't matter.
So a system, the actual shape of the track. So you've got the actual shape of the track. And notice if you had, when you're doing your recording, you had this actual shape of the track, numerous previous runs. And if you could do that prediction on what the rate of change of each site was, you could actually do a prediction of what the shape of the track would look like in 3 months' time. Now, if you then had Gary's bank of computers, instead of running simulated vehicles across today's track that you've just measured, what if you run it across what the track was predicted to look like in 3 months' time? And instead of saying you would have a defect from that vehicle, that model, that simulated vehicle on today's track, what if you could say you would have a defect, you will have a defect in 3 months' time from that vehicle? So this idea of tying stuff together, so it's a challenge for people in the audience, who may have that experience in this sort of stuff. Might there be some possibility to do this? Might there be some benefits? In fact, now Graham was showing the speed restrictions. You're saying at the current rate of change, this vehicle that's running across here, you could predict at what point you might need to impose a speed restriction. With a system like tying these two together, you might be able to say, at some point in the future, as of this date, this vehicle that hasn't even run across it, but we've got a simulated vehicle in this bank of computers, one of these simulated vehicles, that one would need a speed restriction at three months' time. So you've got 3 months to go and fix the track. So I put a challenge to everyone here. What do you think about this idea of being able to do, combining these technologies, predicting degradation, deterioration, predicting what the track shape will look like at some point in the future, and then doing simulation of vehicles across that in order to predict when you will need to do repairs to the track. So that's a challenge, a question. Would anyone have any responses, any suggestions? I'll sit down for some.
One of the questions, sorry, can you just stand up, because I think people are unable to see Brad. Especially when you're talking, I think the volume is
dropping.
Sorry.
Mr. Chair, right?
No, I'm too short. But one of the questions I've had is, how important is the geometry that's actually underpinning the condition?
Only if you're not having all these other revenue vehicles, if they're not instrumented, if you've got a very broad mix of traffic in your area, and you can't instrument them all, which I think you should be, but so saying that you can't, and you've got to use Gary's techniques, which is simulation, that's the only reason it would be important.
Agreed.
Or bring down the price of instrument for new business.
If people buy enough, the price will come down. Come on. Can Ruffy do a deal for you? And unless we can start to introduce some of these other techniques that we were talking about, you know, in terms of taking the response of one wagon and extrapolating that to other wagon types using this clever stuff that young guys.
That's all right if you have a single type of vehicle or a whole lot of vehicles that are very similar.
No, this is taking it to the next level where instrument all the wagons, but only temporarily. From that, develop the relationships for that particular vehicle type to the track condition or the track as an input. Then you can effectively use that interview and then effectively keep one of these wagons, and it could be a track or something, as the one wagon to provide you with that ongoing.
Because the aim is to be predictive rather than reactive.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's the goal, ultimate goal.
Yeah, that's, and that's why, you know, the IOC or IRV or whatever you want to call it is great for the, you know, the problem areas. I mean, I think everyone accepts them as being a really great tool for those areas that you weren't aware of. You know, the severity ones, the critical points, the ones that you haven't picked up for. Yeah. But to me, the absolute strength of this information is not only that. Yes, it's a really important tool because it's out there every day. But the second thing is, it should be a really powerful tool for predictions into the future. I don't know where else predictions go. Predictions. because you're just collecting so much information that the real problem is it's how you distill that down and make sure that it's a meaningful trend going forward. And I know some of the guys here sort of have, you know, generalised linear modelling and a lot of fancy ways of, you know, bringing that information together to make sure that your extrapolations aren't just linear. You know, you look at individual wagon types and classes and
I don't understand any of that.
No, neither do I.
But is there anyone in the audience that does that can explain it? There's a
dingy. No, in effect, what it's saying is that, you know, what you want to do is try and take out some of the scatter in that data going forward. Try and understand what sits behind the variability in responses. Yeah, the fact is that we've got some of those graphs might have had 30 or 40 or 50 different wagons feeding in its input to the trend. Yeah. But if you normalise that, doing some fancy maths, which I don't understand, I can assure you, can you effectively get a much higher level of confidence in your projections going forward? That's, I think, if you want better answers.
Can you push it forward a bit? Because my challenge is having got the data and doing some prediction and actually say, well, my next access opportunity to my network is different opportunities. So Brisbane's suburban area, not say streets, and some parts you get once a year, some parts you get once in 6 months, and if you're lucky, there's some parts you get in 3 months. So that's one of the reasons we've been pushed to have a far more proactive prediction system, because we say, well, we need to know what we're going to do. Because with the exception of actually an absolute emergency, which you get from Facebook or email, you need more pressure not to do that. We did the best country not to do that. So the challenge for us is actually to make sure that we plan all our work assess the total volume of work and make sure it never exceeds the access opportunities in the network so that we flood the resource in, we do the work, we pack up shop, and some parts we've got to pack another year.
Yeah, but I see. I mean, with all of this information, it is very easy to prioritise every section of track that you have. But then ultimately what you need to do is be able to combine that into what are the priority areas.
Can you cast it forward? Is it?
Well, I believe, yeah. There's no reason why any section... It depends how far you're looking at projecting forward.
Yeah.
I mean, we haven't gone out that far, but I don't know where there's any... A lot of these sections where you see no deterioration, you know, there's been no change in response, I'm sure you could assign a reasonable priority level. And again, I think that would be one of the challenges that we'd need to do. Because you look at some of these trends over 12 months, they've been quite linear in terms of the way they've deteriorated. Others with it.
But I'm sure when you show the samples, you show those ones that have a predictable and linear rate of deterioration. But as you showed with the response to rain, there are lots of things that are not that predictable.
But there's nothing you can do about those, unless you go and fix up all the... Now, a lot of those areas are probably known problem areas. They're the mud holes or they're something else that are going to respond.
Right? Maybe there's other ways of identifying those areas through ground penetrating radar, for example, or through...
Can I just jump in, Alex? I think when you don't have a quick chance of getting on an fixing a problem. That's where you need confidence on your data, because you want to really predict as much as far as possible. And if you have only 2 points, you can actually draw the line anywhere you want and say, I can actually leave it for as long as I want and then I can get there. But you need to have a lot of points so that you know that whenever you are going to leave it for a year, it's going to fix something. So that is an important point. I think that is one of the things that we keep on banging our head, because that geometry car data, if we can get that data regularly, every day, I think it's much better. You are in a much better condition to say what is happening and you can actually get that information. I think that's the first thing. I don't know whether the impression came about that we are against the track geometry data. I think the track geometry data is important, and also understanding how the vehicle is performing under that track geometry data is quite important as well. The predictions that we are showing there, or Graham showed there, in a way, it is lumped into the whole group. We have got a couple of graphs that we can actually show. If you break that into a S class, C class, a Q class, you can actually see the bands. So straight away you can know that if you leave the S class, it'll actually work this way. And suddenly if there's a rain, what would happen? Because we have done some work on machine learning on a rain situation, what would happen in that environment. So you get a ground penetration data and say this is a possible soft area. You need to really know what would happen to that track and how the response is going to be. And that is the challenge for the youngsters. And like there are a few PhDs are working on this particular issue with some certain academics who are machine learning experts. So we are trying to bring those capabilities.
So that's the challenge we have currently. We did a complete GPR around about 2 years ago. So the problem is we've only got 1 point in the graph. So now we're thinking we need the second point, at least the second point, even for a longer term asset like Barnes to actually help us. Okay, if the heavens do open and water gets all over Brisbane, we're not going to have problems. Because I need to know now, so fix them before I don't have the opportunity, if that makes sense. I think Graham's point was, do you need track recording data if you know the output of them for every single vehicle? I think the answer is no, I don't need track recording. If I knew the output of the vehicle, what do I need track recording data? Well, that's a lead indicator.
No, I think the answer to that is, I think I might put a negative argument against what I've been talking about, is that, if you know the track geometry data, you bring a new vehicle into the same system, you need to know how do you actually that will perform. So if you know the track geometry car regular information, and you know all the other vehicle how they are performing, and that's Mithushan's, at the moment, current project with AIC, is actually you run a passenger car, what is going to happen to the freight wagon which is going to run on it before even it runs, because we know how it actually behaves on that condition. Can you predict? The question that John asked, can you predict in 3 months' time what would happen? It's a bit more harder, but if you have enough information that we can predict the track geometry and the performance of that wagon, then we can actually start looking at that. So I think that is where we can pull everything together. But I'll leave just to Chris how you want to run, because I think this is probably an interesting section of today's presentation, because we want to see whether the current standards are really looking at these aspects and they are meeting our modern requirements, what you are talking about here. Isn't it? I think that's the topic.
So we're on topic.
We have a topic? Okay.
And I think it's going quite well.
Well, also, I think you all didn't ask any questions from Gary. Gary, why don't you come in front? Because then you can also participate. I think you're far away from here. Andrew, join in front. I think probably you should have Grant. Come over. Bill has already gone. You can actually grab John, because I think John is the Phil's replacement. John, why don't you come and join in?
Sit down.
Any other questions, please?
Yeah, right. So the discussion which we've been having is, to my mind, is one about asset management, because it's the asset manager saying, when do I need to come into the vendor, what do I need to do? The headline was standards, so I'd be interested in anyone's comments about what sort of standards people like John and I need to be writing to guide our industry in the right way. So the standards need to be written for tomorrow's railway, not for yesterday's and today's. So what do we need to be including in there?
If I could maybe respond to that.
Yeah,
respond a bit to that without being a track engineer. But what I found interesting over today is how the debate has moved from a reactive response for maintenance to trying to be predictive. And the discussion that we've just had seems to be around how predictive can we be, how much information do we need, and that three-month prediction window. I don't think it's important that we are confident that we have to be 100% sure on our predictions. It's an evolutionary path. And if the standards or instructions that we think about improve from where we currently are reactive to being a bit better at being predictive, I mean, if you get it right one time in two, that's 1 or 50% of defects that will be resolved before they become a defect. That's a step forward in its own right. And also, don't get sucked in. I would suggest that working out all the data that you need for the perfect prediction. Because I'm a believer, as soon as you get some data, the first thing you'll decide is you need more. And there's so much information, I think, floating around already. So if we need a standard of guidance now, it's about what to focus on and how to make the best use of the data that we can have. But there was some terrific information, I think, from Graham and Gary, and from my point of view, really a very positive eye-opening experience.
Yeah, I'd like to make the point that we talked about track recording cars to know exactly what the geometry is. Well, I'm not sure that's quite right. What wavelength are you recording the top at? Are you measuring it at 20 metre inertial, 10 metre chord, 6 metre chord? Because you do your Fourier transfer and you'll find that you've missed some data. What we're really looking for is the ride of all vehicles over the track, which is pretty much what young John Paff said, and what I have to
it's all well. Not normal, John.
So really, we want to find out what defects, of course, it may arise, so measure right. Then you've got to define the repair, which is where you are coming from. What's the effectiveness of repair? And too often we send out a tamper to repair geometry. When I was younger than John, we had EM80s or whatever they were, and we worked out three standard deviations of the trace. We'd work that out, not to add them together to a track condition index, which I don't know about the mathematics of adding three standard deviations of the weight of apples to the weight of pineapples. It doesn't really make a lot of sense.
But it's stuck.
It's been hijacked by some people anyway. The value of the three standard deviations is that any discrete fault that exceeds three standard deviations of that trace is probably not part of the parent population. So the whole point is you've got to go out there and find out the underlying fault and fix that. So that was the when these cars first came out and we had computers. So that's the effectiveness which you were talking about, Bill. You mentioned it too, Graham, about the effectiveness of your results, and you track it by your...
For the effectiveness of maintenance.
Yes. Mm-hmm. If you do the wrong thing, it'll be back there tomorrow.
Actually, one of the slides I had, we did some work in the 80s where we actually looked at the maintenance in terms of the transfer function before and after maintenance. So you run the recording car immediately before maintenance and again immediately after maintenance to see how effective you were on a piece of track in terms of knocking out the different frequency components. And I mean, I can't remember the numbers now, but there are a couple of things that stood out. One, there was an incredibly high level of variability in terms of how effective tamping was, in terms of, there were many frequency bands where they actually became worse after maintenance. So I mean, this is one of the things that, in terms of, if you're going to chuck a tamper out there, do you have any confidence whatsoever that it's likely to be able to correct the issue, cyclic top or whatever it might be, the errors that are actually in that track?
I think the important bit there is you've got some data processing that comes out, and you need to acknowledge that that is
a bit of information or use data, but you need to have someone who understands what they're looking at to make a decision on whether it's going to go. What is the answer? Is the answer a temple will give me a truck my answer, or do I need to go and do something else to relieve the problem? Do I need to grind the rail?
So as I said, the truck recording, from my point of view, as the asset manager, says that it only tells me the symptoms. It doesn't actually tell me the cause. I've got to send some qualified people out, I'll do some more analysis, just like the rail investigation, but the actual cause. Tampering might well be then the solution, or it might be called something different, reballasting, or change the rail, or grinding, or anything else. And one of the things we've definitely done the last few years is actually trying to get our engineers back out and see. You just don't tamper as a response to what you do. You find out what the hell is wrong, and you fix it.
But the thing is, probably 90% of the time it's tamper.
No. If someone comes back to me and says, I fixed top line with tamping, I want to shoot them.
Okay.
I want you to you tell me what the problem is.
Yeah.
And then you top and line is not a false.
That's precisely the point. Tamping might be the last thing you do after you fix the problem.
I think it's very important that you can run the track measuring the car the next day and actually see what the result is of the work that you've done.
Yeah,
of course. And you're going to get information that will help you learn very quickly that, you know, you can probably already know that tamping isn't the solution for most situations.
But I was lucky during a period of St. Grenoble to have the early ride model, which is an accelerometer in the UK HSTs. And it was just the box in the corner for me in technology, the old brick trail research, that no one was looking at. Once we figured out what it did, the fact that it did, like whether your maintenance was effective or where to go and look, we started to use it, and it was a game changer. We got to put it away because it was the end of the trial. And I think there was another comment made earlier about engineers being swamped with data. I can remember saying, when they went to Fort Bloody Track Recording UK and weekly with the new measurement train, the engineers going, oh, how can we code? And then a year later, when they had to go for maintenance, they went back to 2 weekly. They had the opposite thing. How am I going to code without it? So, you adapt. Human beings adapt to the data. We soon catch up to going from big to huge.
So Bill's question, can I just try to make it a bit more verbose than the question that he asked? Bill's question was, what do you actually write when you're writing the standards to look after the track maintenance? Okay?
Yes.
I would suggest that track maintenance, when you're writing the track maintenance standards, you should put something like, you had actually have a track which is capable of having a ride control, comfort, less than a certain amount. So that you actually link it to the vehicle performance, or vehicle, somebody who's sitting inside the vehicle, to give them the best. Because when you heard what Phil said, I think what was his terminology about railworthiness? Is it fit for purpose, and is it actually giving what you have actually agreed to provide? And at the end of the day, you had actually combined both vehicle and track. Let's say how we get it is the next question. The first one is, how do you actually give the best ride for the person who is running on inside the train, or the freight which is sitting in the train? And then we work out what are the things which are contributing to that particular ride comfort, and then try to fix it. You know, then we take Gary's approach of doing the modeling, or Graham's approach of instrumenting, or whatever. But then you actually start talking about how you fix the whole problem. Is that fair?
I was actually coming on with a similar, that's where we should go. I think we should be building off what these guys have already told us. Gary started today, and he's very effectively told us about the problems associated with the way the FRA is very prescriptive in its standards, and it's a bit stifling. It doesn't allow you to innovate, to find more efficient ways of doing track maintenance. I think Andy explained that we have a very different regulatory system in this country, and we don't have the FRA that comes down on us telling us what to do. But we've got Jesse Baker up in that corner, the representative of RISBY here, and RISBY has been asked all the time to provide standards. So could we conclude, Gary, from your experience, you've explained what not to do, we've actually got the opportunity to do it right. We've got the regulator here who says we have a different regulatory environment, is prepared to accept a different level of regulation. We've got the standards writer here
first issue is whether, I don't know that much about your standards. I think they're more comprehensive than the, I think they're more, from what I have worked with down here, they're more comprehensive than the FRA, and they cover more situations. And so maybe you're capturing more than we are. I mean, I gave you 6-7 examples of my frustrations, and that's the tip of the iceberg of what I've showed you, how many derailments that I've gone to where we've met the standard, yet track was the principal contributor. Now, I don't know if that's true in Australia across your networks. Do you have examples of similar situations? Has that occurred? Or do you think your standards are more comprehensive to capture those resonance things and what have you?
Fortunately, from a safety perspective, but unfortunately from a statistical perspective, we don't have that many derailments. So it's hard to get sort of any statistics on it. But we always have derailments where the track was pretty bad but didn't quite trip the standards, and the vehicles were pretty bad but didn't quite trip the standards. But what we try and encourage is the standard is not the absolute. Everyone who's responsible for the track should still be responsible for the safety of the track, and the standards are there to aid them in their primary goal, which is ensure the safety, or ensure the continued management of the track. And the rolling stock people are the same. They should take the view that their responsibility is to ensure the safety of the asset, and the standards are there to help them, but they still have the responsibility. We don't want to fall into the trap of thinking that blind compliance with a suite of standards is sufficient. It's necessary, but not sufficient.
It can be quite dangerous, because if people are underfunded and they're going right down to the limit,
they'll push that boundary.
The rest of the asset degrades, and all of a sudden they get this very quickly overwhelmed by all these a priority defects, which they should be dealing with. They're up 300-day defects, and now they come down to 14 days and 1 day, because they've been investing their effort in targeting just the ones.
But does that also, if we think too about the safety legislation, say it's in the regulator here, it's not prescriptive with standards, we can talk, I still think we're talking about two things. We're talking certainly about technical standards that define what the right quality might be, what various engineering parameters of the asset are, and that's certainly for the operators to work out. But what we've been talking about, I think, in the afternoon is how we can manage safety better within all these technical requirements, how we can predict a significant defect, and a defect avoided, to my mind, is good safety management, and maybe that's the challenge now. I mean, we've been told about a whole host of technology and issues, and whether they're appropriate for your relevant businesses is for you to work out, but how do we manage track maintenance?
Isn't that the difference between a safety standard and
the law requires standards, safety standards, to describe the physical, technical aspect, but also how you do maintenance, design, construction, and how you do it safely. And if we're beginning to get into the space of thinking, rather than just responding to a defect, we've got a model somewhere, we're going to fix it, we've now actually got a tool that says, well, in a couple of months we might have a problem there. Surely the onus might be on us to use that knowledge and be smarter at what we do.
The knowledge you use actually isn't in the track. I look at the track on civil, however, it's my track side colleague, ironically, he's an Irishman. Because a lot of the signal equipment has got monitoring equipment on it, or some of the key elements, then we can tell, you know, when the speed is slower to a certain point. But often the reason for that isn't actually a track side issue. The signal equipment's fine, it's the track underneath it that's blocking the rain. So our intervention isn't because of a civil issue, it's actually because of a railway ballistic issue, which is actually, I want to swing the pond to swing across, and I want it to be detected, and I don't want to be so powerful in the relatively networking. So I think it's what you said, Gary, about my answer would be fine. It doesn't mean they're always fine.
Okay.
It means I just transfer the risk somewhere else. So we've started to mean, I'm not saying we go all the time, but where that's available, whatever smarts are out there we can use. And the standards are surely the limit, the minimums, they're not.
So how much of the activity, I suppose, is really safety focused, and how much of it should be just about managing the asset in the most cost effective way? I mean, yeah, safety is very much at the extreme.
A good asset management plan keeps you well away from your safety.
That's absolutely so therefore things like cost imperatives and what's best practice and all of those things should be feeding into, you know, what track quality should I accept, you know, what level of dynamics, all of those sorts of things are that's where we ought to be trying to target, to understand what is the cost or the impact or of running. And it's a lot easier in a closed system where, as someone said before, the only thing that really matters is what's the minimum cost to transport a ton of iron ore safely. I mean, obviously in a lot of the systems these days, the track owners will go, well, why should I maintain the track better when it just means that the blokes at the top are going to get the benefit? And vice versa, why should I maintain my wheel? And that's where some of the real challenges come in, I think, as well. But, yeah, I don't think anyone's really got a sense of how good should a track be or how bad should a track be from the point of view of, you know, obviously you need to stay away from safety limits, but...
Well, here's a fundamental question, though. How many people in the room are vehicle people? Here's your problem, right there. We're all in here talking about track in a vacuum. We have no concept of what vehicles. Now, if I'm in the Pilbara, I know what kind of vehicles I'm running. I may have a different standard up there because I'm limited on the vehicle types. You may have a different standard on the national network. So, but you have to know, if you're going to design track to do something, what's it going to do? Carry vehicles. You got to know the type of vehicles and the condition of those vehicles to design to a limit that will accommodate those vehicles. And that's kind of the point I'm trying to make, that we design these standards, and we don't consider that the vehicle coming down the track may have tight bearings, tight side bearings, or it may have a twist in the car body, or it may have an off-centered load. And I think we have to be realistic to accommodate the vehicle conditions that the networks are going to carry. So the guys who do ARTC on more of a national network with various franchise operators, you may have a different set of standards than people running a metro system, one vehicle type every day back and forth. And so I don't think we can do a one-size-fits-all. You have to design to the environment that you're carrying, whether it's passenger freight and the type of vehicle. So
that's a very good point.
In the U.S., we have a conference called the WRI. And I think maybe some of you have been to it over the years. It's Wheel Rail Interface. And we've really made an effort to get more vehicle people involved, and we've reached that success. And it's a very interesting conference to see the perspective on both sides. And here we sit in a room talking about track geometry with a couple, maybe 1.5 vehicle people in here, okay? And I'm not criticizing, I'm just saying it was billed as a geometry session. I don't think any wrench turners are going to come to that, okay? But, we got it. Maybe next year if you do a workshop, you might address vehicle stuff and try to bring that component into it and get the parties talking more. But, back to what standards should we be moving to? And I mean, one point I tried to make was that when we design our standards, whether it's top or alignment or gauge, do we sit there and run simulations and analysis and say, well, if we accept this top, what is that going to do if I let the gauge go to its limit and I let the alignment go to its limit? How does that standard for top now work with everything at other parameters at their limits? And that's what I'm trying to get across, is many of these derailments, we see multiple geometry perturbations at their limits or near their limits, but not ringing the bell, and we go out in the weeds because of it. So I've been critical of FRA for setting standards. I've talked to them. I've gone up there, shown them presentations of how these cross-pollinized defects, if you will, put us off in the woods, and yet it's like talking to the wall here sometimes. They got their set, they're going to do it this way, and I think we need to move beyond that framework of logic, that's all.
We do it well for clearance diagrams.
We what?
We do it well for clearance on the left.
Right, you got it, yeah. Yeah, that's a good point.
And we don't build our bridges any closer than here.
Right.
And you're not going to make your wagon any bigger than that.
That's an excellent point.
And we put an air gap and everyone's happy.
It's a lesson we learned only a couple of years ago on the twist test. When you accept the vehicle gets subjected to a twist test, the wheel unloading. And as it turned out, the limits for the twist test didn't correspond to the limits for what a track inspector looks for in terms of track twist. There was this overlap where a vehicle didn't have to negotiate a particular size twist, but the track inspector could have that size of that twist in the track. So we had to realign the standards and combine them so that the two different sides of the system both align.
I was quite surprised several years ago. I did a derailment work project down here, and I found out at the time there was no national vehicle standards. Is that still true, or like a train that leaves Sydney?
Jesse, would you like to answer?
Might have one set of standards, but a train operating in WA, the vehicles may be subjected to another standard. And I don't know how you run a national network without a national standard.
One of the first big wins from RISB, which is our Railway Industry Safety and Standards Board, which is writing Australian standards, one of the first big wins is harmonisation of those accepted standards and the fundamental interface standards for rolling stock.
It's now done?
It's been a big win.
The national law requires us to have interface standards, and RISB has made sure that the above rail standards are compatible with the below rail standards.
And there is definitely an
Australian standard for wagon acceptance.
Across the
world. And as John pointed out, we found a hole to where there was an overlap. You've got to get a safety factor between the two.
Maybe I should explain. We've talked a little bit about the respective structures of the two industries in the different countries. And John's sort of drawn me into the conversation. I've sat here all day biting my tongue, which is not an easy thing for me to do. But it's a little bit different here. These people here have the RISB as a resource to help them write their own standards. So the industry comes together as a collective, comes to us, asks us to then put pen to paper, and we sort of tap into the collective wisdom of the experts around the room and transpose all that wisdom into words on the page. So we don't have that same situation where you go and make recommendations at the FRA and bang your head on a wall. But I guess that earlier today we were talking about whether or not what we've got currently written in the RISB standards is right. And the subject of this workshop is about whether or not these maintenance standards are right for the railway going into the future. So the invitation is there. If we've solved some of these problems and we know what we want our standards to say going into the future, come talk to us and we'll help you write them down.
Blake's at the front have been doing a lot of talking. Yeah, Mina.
Hi, a couple of questions, or a couple of comments. So, we talk a lot about the standards and how the standards regulate what we do and our responses and things like that. So, one of the big things we don't talk about is competence. Competence of the people looking at the data and how they assess the data. And who, I suppose, we're looking at large amounts of data across the network and all the things that we need to do. Typically, a lot of systems, from what I've seen, tend to bring people in who are good at reading data, but not necessarily understand the data they're looking at. Is there some way that we can regulate as an industry the level of training and skill required for some people to actually assess this data? Because I don't think you always necessarily need engineers at the high level. So at the high level, the engineer will vet the information. So someone at a lower level will provide them with a list of defects that they need to assess or review. Then there's that level below the engineers, like a technical officer, a review officer, or something like that, looks at all this stuff. So is there something like that that we could look at, I suppose, from a regulation perspective? Is that a question?
So, the guy that actually analyses all the track recording data is not a technical officer, he's not an engineer, he's a very experienced supervisor who started by shoveling marks. But he's very computer literate. He's gone that way. He's actually taught himself to understand the technology.
But that's not always the case.
No, I'm not seeing that. I'd like to clone him. Yes.
He has the confidence.
Correct.
But it's important, I think, anyone who's
doing work that might direct maintenance or faulting is competent to do that task. It doesn't need another regulation. I think our current laws and regulations are sufficient. But you do need someone who knows what they're doing. And whether that means defining a set of statistical knowledge or engineering knowledge, but I think industry needs to be sure that
the first thing will gain it in two avenues.
Well, yes, there's lots of ways of gaining it. I don't think it needs a new regulation.
And it may not be one person. You may have your data analysis wizard who deals with big data and draws patterns and all this sort of stuff. And you have your guy who actually understands what happens with rail. And between the two of them might actually be a more powerful combination. Say, well, we have to have one person who can do all of it. They're not even entity. They're rarer than that.
So it is an important thing if you wrote. There is a different confidence there. And you can't take the track inspector who spent his entire life with a testing camera and give him a computer, unless you give him the right training across him. Same, you can't take a machine learning specialist and just say,
this is an opportunity to discuss. I think the purpose of this workshop is actually to discuss and capture this information and help out Jesse to start putting the correct standards that are relevant. So, any other comments?
Response that is defined in the standard, that person will have be very assessed as, we call them, a civil engineering representative,
yes.
And they go through quite a detailed analysis of the contributing parameters to that fault. And generally they're not allowed to change the level of the fault. Generally it's only the response time, and it's generally to do with the speed is going to deteriorate. They're all slightly different, and the boundary that they're allowed to work in is quite tightly defined. So it's not just a carte blanche to ignore that fault.
I could also add that standards are only written for standard situations. That might be a 90th percentile or a 99th percentile situation. There'll always be that 10% or 1% of non-standard situations. And you do need to give, you can't be absolutely black and white about it. You need to give someone the opportunity to appropriately manage that specific site according to their competency and according to the needs of that specific site. So it is a bit of a get out clause, but it's actually not a get out of jail clause, it's a get into jail clause. Because if you do it wrong, you get yourself into jail. But it is to allow for those non-standard situations.
Yeah, and sometimes the track recording cable flat off. You can't just stop trains because it gives a huge fault. They get someone there very quickly and sign it off as a flat line, but then there's no work to be done. So they'll alter the response. But they won't alter the size of the fault.
All right.
I might throw one
there didn't seem to be a large list of them. So there was lots of discussion we've had around, and people sort of saying, yeah, we want this, we want that. I would appreciate it if you had a half-baked idea or a well-rounded idea to send into the RISB committee so we can start acting on it. It's always better to have a list of stuff to choose from than be sort of scratching me going, well, what do you want to do, John? So, I don't know.
There are several RISB committee members here, and perhaps John, if you and any others, if you put up your hand, you'll know where to send those ideas in.
We have made the suggestion that, as Jesse said, RISB is here for the industry, for the members, and if members identify a need for some RISB product, typically a standard or a guideline or something like that, if members identify a need, let RISB know, and it makes it onto a list, and then members get to vote on that list. So don't think that RISB, those people in the setting the National Australian Standards, necessarily know all of your problems. So don't be afraid to contact RISB or some RISB representative and say, hey, I've got this idea for things that would help me. It has the potential to help others. Could you run it past the others? And RISB can do that, I think.
Just following on from that, I mean, you can do that at any time, but now is a really good time to do it because we're actually putting together our work plan for the next financial year. So if you want something done in a relatively short order, now's a really good time to be feeding in those sorts of ideas.
That's John Dr. Pat.
All right, thank you all. So it is time to wrap up. So just a quick summary on what we've done today. I think we've had a really good look at different technologies from Gary and Graham. We've got a much better understanding of the regulatory environment from Andy, and Phil and John have given us good insight into what ARTC is doing to standards and how that reflects generally with what industry is doing. I think anybody as an intelligent observer of the introduction of new technology in rail will probably observe that it proceeds at a glacial pace. I think events like today are really good ways to get people in a group thinking about this, and I think it was an astute observation from Gary. We didn't really have much of the rolling stock community here. That can be addressed. I think last night there were plenty of rolling stock people, so it's just I think a lot of people in this room would really like to see progress. Introduction of new technology that needs to be supported by standards, proper safety analysis, proper risk analysis. The benefits will be, first of all, business benefits, because you'll be fixing things before they impact on the business. I think we often, particularly those in the safety field, focus on the safety, but I think the business impacts will be there and will pay for the technology for the safety. Aspects come, but the safety benefits are there as well, and we will need to improve in safety generally. So I think on that note, I think I'd just like to thank the panel members for participating, for presenting,
for leaving me in the hot seat.
Thank you, the audience, for coming, for participating, particularly in the workshop. For coming last night, which most of you did, I think your participation has made it extremely valuable and much better than what an average conference might be. I'm feeling confident that we will see progress out of today. And